Welcome to the sports podcast that will put you in the zone all the time. Welcome to Pac Sports Zone with me, your host, Peter Pacman Clarke. What's going on, guys? We're here for another week of Pac Sports Zone, and it's been a couple weeks, so we got a lot to talk about. Going through all four major sports as the playoffs are running wild in the NHL and the NBA. We're about one-third of the way through the baseball season. And a lot of football talk as we're getting more near to the season in a couple more months. We just coming off the draft in a couple weeks ago. So lots to talk about, including a little bit of wrestling at the end as we got Double or Nothing pay-per-view for AEW coming up on Sunday. But let's get right into it as MLB, just to got a couple things to start on. As I said, we're about 50 games into a season, around one-third. And just some of the quick outlooks on each division. AL East, a 3-0 team race. Tampa Bay, New York, and the surprising Red Sox, who have actually played very well so far to start the season. Yankees got off to a horrible start to start the season. They've woken up. They're expected to take that division, but we'll see what happens as we get on into the year, as we get closer to the All-Star break, about I would say 5-6 weeks away from that. In the Central and the AL, White Sox, which is expected, have taken the lead in that division. They've controlled it a little bit. They lead, I think, by about 6 games right now, if not more. They've been pretty in control of that division, and that was expected because White Sox were picked to go to the World Series. So we'll see if that continues or if they'll get a challenge. And the West is also kind of expected, as the A's, who played well last year, have continued their good play. And the Houston Astros, obviously, they're a good team, and they're always going to be up there, so they're battling out for the AL West. Well, when you go to the NL East, I mean, the entire NL East is within 4 games of 500. Mets are 4 games over. Other than the last place team, is about 2 games within 500 or so, 2-3 games. It's just going to be a battle that's going to go on to the end. This was expected to be arguably the best division in baseball, and they really haven't played like it. The Braves are filled with injuries. The Mets are breaking down with injuries. So this could continue a while as they start a 3-game series starting today. And that'll go into the weekend, into Memorial Day weekend. Moving on to the Central, Chicago Cubs off to a good start. They were off to a good start last year, and then they died out as the year was ending. We'll see if they can keep it up this year. St. Louis, after getting Nolan Arenado, he's the guy that was supposed to push them back to the top of the division, and right now they're doing that. So the Cubs and the Cardinals are both fighting out to see who's going to take that division. But I think it'll be a good race the rest of the way. I'm not sure if a team like Cincinnati will be able to challenge them, but right now it's just Chicago Cubs and the St. Louis Cardinals, old school rivalry time. Out west, now, San Francisco Giants got off to a great start this year. They were leading the division for the first couple weeks of the season. Recently, San Diego and the Dodgers, who the Dodgers got off to a rough start, but the Padres and the Dodgers have finally overcome the Giants. They're up on them by, I think, about a game or half a game. But it took them a while, but they finally gotten there. And now it looks like the battle will resume of the Padres and the Dodgers fighting for that division, as the Giants are not expected to stay up there with them. So it's going to be a good race, though, because those are two really good teams. Those are the two teams that are the highest in terms of odds to win the NL. So it's going to be a battle all the way to the end and including into the playoffs. So that should be a very good battle between the Padres and the Dodgers. But that's just wanted to talk quickly on each of the division, so that we'll talk more about it as the weeks go on, as we get closer to the All-Star break, and see what teams that are leading at the All-Star break will not be holding their leads in the second half of the year. Just a quick talk on football. There's two major topics obviously going on. Aaron Rodgers still wants out. I still say the only way that the Green Bay Packers will be able to keep him will be fire the GM, will be to trade Jordan Love, and probably fire the coach, and then obviously he would need a contract extension. I don't think the Packers are willing to do this, so I think Aaron Rodgers probably has played his last game as a Green Bay Packer. And that's something. Now, when they drafted Jordan Love, I said he'll play last year. I said he would play this year, and they would trade him the year after. He has kind of forced it to where they have to make a decision right now. It's either And one thing that could push it, I think he may sit out. I know a lot of players always hold out during OTAs, and then they come back and play when the season's about to start. I think this is a little bit different for Rodgers. I think he's actually going to sit out games, and he may sit out this year. So I think this is going to be a situation where he's either going to be traded, and I have no idea where he could be traded. I think the best spot for him would be with the Las Vegas Raiders. I think for the first time that the Death Star, as people call it, having fans in that stadium in Las Vegas for the first time, it would be unbelievable if the quarterback for that first game was Aaron Rodgers. And who knows if they may try to trade for somebody like Julio Jones, who is also available with the Atlanta Falcons. And that brings into that second topic where I was talking about Julio Jones. He's pretty much said his two teams that he would like to go to. Now, he can get traded to whoever the Falcons want to trade him to. However, they would like to treat him with respect, as he's probably the most prolific athlete, but in terms of production for the Atlanta Falcons history in the history of their team. So they want to try to do right by him. Right now, he's saying the Patriots and the Titans are the two teams he wants to go to. It makes sense because it seems like every player wants to play for Bill Belichick at one point in their career. And the Patriots are going to bounce back. He also wants to play with Cam Newton, who I guess he's friends with. And it also makes sense with Tennessee because he went to school, obviously, same school as Derrick Henry. He is the idol of A.J. Brown. That's the reason why A.J. Brown wears 11 is because of Julio Jones. And the Tennessee Titans fans on Twitter are all calling for Julio Jones, and you have videos being made for him and everything. So the Titans definitely want to be in. There's a rumor that there's a first-round pick for him. I don't know if the Titans will go to a first-round pick. I think they should, but we'll see what happens with that. But the weird thing on Twitter is how the Ravens, the Kansas City Chiefs, and the Colts fans are just complaining and just hating so much on the Titans. He hasn't even been traded to the Titans yet, and they're hating so much. Julio Jones has come out and said, I want to be on a team that's going to win. All the fans of those teams are saying, well, why would you go to the Titans? Well, the Titans have five straight seasons of winning seasons. 2 years ago, they went to the AFC Championship game. Last year, they won 11 games and won the division. They're a winning team. They're one of, I think there's only five teams that have winning streaks of three seasons or more in a row with winning seasons. Titans have five. I think there's only three teams that have five winning seasons in a row or more. Like, this is a team that is winning now. They just need to make that big step, which is why I think they should trade for Julio Jones. I mean, they were the number three team in offense in terms of yardage last year, the number four team in terms of points scored per game last year. When you look at that and you add Julio Jones to replace Corey Davis, you're actually upgrading and making that offense better. You're making that offense similar to the Kansas City Chiefs, which is considered the best offense in the league. You have to double team A.J. Brown. You have to double team Julio Jones. But yet you still want to put 7-8 men in the box for Derrick Henry. It's impossible to do that. You can't play defense with 13 players. So either Julio Jones is going to be single covered, which will hurt you. A.J. Brown will be single covered, which will hurt you. Or you're going to have six men in the box for Derrick Henry. Good luck going against that. So this is a move that I think you have to do if you're Tennessee Titans. You turn yourself into a top three offense, in my opinion. And the defense should be better because of Bud Dupree now being a pass rusher. They got, obviously, Autry in the middle to be a pass rusher from D-tackle. And they completely revamped their secondary by getting rid of a lot of high-priced players, whether it's Adoree Jackson, whether it's Malcolm Butler, whether it's Kenny Vaccaro, and replacing them with their first-round pick, Caleb Farley, replacing them with Janoris Jenkins on a solid low contract, and going with him for Amani Hooker at safety, who led them at interceptions last year. You also got Jayon Brown coming back. He's their best coverage linebacker, and he comes back from an injury last year. So they're going to have eight new players on defense compared to the team on defense that ended the year last year. So their defense is going to be completely different. So if you turn a 11-5 team with a god-awful defense and make them even an average defense, and you improve on that offense, that's definitely a Super Bowl contender. I think there's a move Tennessee has to do, but we'll see what happens, as a trade is expected to be done probably within the next week. So keep your eye out for that. Quick stop. Also, I want to talk about the NHL. I haven't talked about the NHL on this podcast yet, but I think it deserves it because they have been having a really good playoffs. Now, the Bruins open tonight against the New York Islanders after Boston pretty much ran through the Caps 4-1, and the Islanders beat Pittsburgh Penguins 4-2, so that should be a good, interesting series. Colorado and Winnipeg ran through their opponents in the first round, both with sweeps. I would say probably the most interesting series ended last night with Carolina and Nashville. Now, after Carolina won the first two games pretty handily, both games they won by 3 goals, they had 4 straight games of overtime, with games 3 and 4 being double overtime games. And last night, Nashville was up 3-1 halfway through the second period. It looked like we're going to a game 7, and then Sebastian Aho hits his 4th goal to make it 3-2, and gets his 5th goal a minute into overtime so they can win the game 4-3. And now Carolina will be moving on to the next round. But it was a very, very good series. I suggest that if you're not even a big hockey fan, but even if you're an average hockey fan or just want to watch something to watch, playoff hockey is one of the best things to watch. It is really fun to watch. There's hard hitting. There's a lot of skill being shown. As you can see already, there's a lot of overtimes and sudden death and a lot of tenseness in the game. It's very fun to watch. So as a fan, and it's crazy if you're one of the fans of the teams, but even if you're not, it's very fun to watch. So I suggest it for people to watch NHL playoff hockey. Moving on to the NBA. Just going over the series real quick. Philadelphia so far has dominated Washington, which was expected. They're up 2 games to none. First game, they struggled a little bit, kept them, but they led the whole way. And the second game, they completely destroyed them. Russell Westbrook left the game early. We saw what happened when the fan poured popcorn over his head. Fans got to chill. I mean, I don't know what's going on with some of these fans. I mean, obviously, we've seen some bad fans in Philly. Same thing happened in New York when we had the fans spit on Trae Young, which is completely stupid. It kind of makes me say Ron Artest had the right idea. I mean, if you're going to go outside your box as a fan and do something to an athlete, throw stuff on him and spit on him, then if he comes into the crowd and punches you in the face, you kind of deserve it. So fans really got to chill. But going back to the actual games, like I said, Philly, Westbrook left the game, was leaving the game when he got the popcorn poured on him while he was hurt, and he was being walked off the court. So right now, Washington's in trouble. I expect that one to be a sweep. Brooklyn also is up 2-0. They've completely dominated Boston. I think Jason Tatum will have 1 big game, and he's been horrible this series. He's been the worst he has been all year. But I think he can have that 150-point game or so, and they can get one. But I think that'll be it. I think Brooklyn's going to win that series probably 4-1. Milwaukee. Now, I admit, I was completely wrong. This one was very unexpected. Miami has been destroyed by the Milwaukee Bucks so far in the first 2 games of the series. And right now, it looks like Milwaukee could sweep them, maybe 4-1. But I thought this was a series that's going to go 7. I thought Miami would actually win this series. So I have to admit, I was completely wrong. Bucks showed some toughness so far in this first round. We'll see if it continues, because the second and third rounds where they've had their issues. So we'll see if Milwaukee will be, once getting by this first round, see what happens when they make it to the next round. And one thing to do that you do have to say is that now they go to Miami, and the old thing Mike Francesa always used to say that I do always remember, the series doesn't start until somebody wins a road game. So right now Milwaukee has won their first 2 home games, just like the other 2 with Philadelphia and Brooklyn. Now, Philadelphia and Brooklyn have been so dominating, I think that they're going to win one of the games on the road, just like I think Milwaukee will. But you do have to wait and see, so that should be a good game 3 to see if Miami's going to put up a fight, or if this is heading towards a sweep. Moving on to the last series in the East, Knicks and Hawks. It's getting a little nasty, as I talked about the spitting incident earlier in New York. Other than that, their crowd has been unbelievable. It has been really, really fun to see the Knicks crowd. And I'm definitely not a Knicks fan. I'm a Bulls fan, so I hate the Knicks as a team. But it has been really fun to see how loud and how enthusiastic the New York Knicks crowd has been. With some of the chants, which may not be safe for TV, but at least they're still fun. That's fine. You can chant anything you want as a fan. I have no problem with that, as long as nothing touches the actual player. So they've been really fun, and that series is getting a little bit nasty. I think it'll go seven because I think they'll split the two in Atlanta, and then we'll see what happens for the last three games, but I think that'll go seven. I think right now I'm picking the Knicks in seven. Moving on to the West, you got the Memphis Grizzlies. They stole game one from the Jazz without Donovan Mitchell playing. Mitchell wins game two with the Jazz, played well in his return. And I think the Jazz will start to take over a little bit in that series. I think there's a good chance they could win both in Memphis. Memphis is a good, solid home team, so they may get one. So it may go six, but I think it could be either Jazz in five or Jazz in six. Lakers, after stumbling in game one, they handled the Suns pretty well in game two and game three. Devin Booker had 30 points in game two, but it was a quiet 30. And in game three, he played bad. He got kicked out on a soft play. I mean, he pushed one of the players from the Lakers, I think it was, and then Anthony Davis, I think it was Schroeder, but then Anthony Davis came and tried to get in his face and tried to get Crowder's face. And it's a lot of, like, fake tough guys in that series. I mean, Crowder, first of all, he's one of the softest fake tough guys there is. So that's one guy. He shouldn't be getting in anybody's face. He's not going to fight anybody. And then you got Davis getting in everybody's face. And after the game saying, oh, that's just dirty basketball. You can't have somebody pushing somebody in the back with two hands while they're in the air. And while there's videos popping up, which I showed on my Twitter, Pacman, P-A-C-M-A-N 453323 on Twitter, which LeBron did the same thing. He's done the same thing to Joel Embiid. Joel Embiid was going for a dunk. LeBron pushed him with two hands, knocked him on the floor. He actually hurt him for a little bit. So I don't want to hear anything out of Anthony Davis that's not no place in the game for that when his own teammate who got him to L.A. is actually doing the same thing. So I'm a big Davis fan, but he can shut up where it comes with that. That's now no place for the game and everything like that. It's tough playoff basketball. It was a hard foul. I don't think it was worth getting kicked out for, but I understand the game was over. It was like 10 seconds to go, so they just kicked him out. But I don't want to hear anything out of Anthony Davis about, oh, you can't do that when your own teammate does that. But that series looks like it's being controlled by the Lakers from now on. Denver and Portland, which was put on NBA TV because obviously TNT wants to have the Lakers on, but that was the better game. Denver led for most of the game, but they were actually, it was a close game most of the way through. Numerous times where the lead was within three, within 5 points, even down to the last couple minutes of the game. I think this has been the best series of all the playoffs so far, including the Knicks have been the best out east. This has been the best out west. Denver now takes a 2-1 lead, and we'll see what happens with game four in Portland. See, Portland's a really good home team, so we'll see if they'll be able to top the series. I think they will. But we'll see. Clippers, this is the biggest disappointment so far, down 0-2. The Clippers lost their last two games of the regular season on purpose, so they wouldn't have to play the Lakers in round two. Yes, they lost on purpose so they could avoid a team that they play well against till round two. And with that being said, they have completely lost all momentum. They dropped up to the fourth seed, which they were the third seed. So now they're the fourth seed, which means they have to play a better team. And that team is the Dallas Mavericks. And the Dallas Mavericks are making them pay for it, as Luka Doncic has been unbelievable through the first two games of the series. First game, he had a triple-double, 31 points, 10 rebounds, 11 assists. In the second game, he had 39 points, 7 rebounds, 7 assists. So Luka's really taking it to the Clippers right now. And now they will be playing in Dallas. You got to think that Clippers will win one of the games in Dallas. Now, if they'll win two, then that'll get them back on track. But you got to think they'll win one. If they were to get swept, you can see that entire team getting broken apart in the offseason, which means Kawhi leaving. That means Paul George traded. You can see that team really break down in this offseason if they get swept. So that's definitely something to keep an eye on. That game will be tonight, so that's something to really watch. That if the Mavericks go up 3-0, there's going to be a lot of talk for game four, to the point where I don't think the Clippers can win a game four if they go down 3-0. Moving on, just to end this podcast, we're trying to go pretty fast today, and we'll come back probably next week to just give some more detailed explanation about everything. But real quick on wrestling, then I'll end it off with boxing. AEW was pushed to tonight, Friday, so because of the NBA Finals game being on TNT, that's their usual station. So that will be tonight if you want to see the last show before their pay-per-view, Double or Nothing, which will be this Sunday. Some of the matches that you obviously want to pay attention to for this Sunday: championship match, Kenny Omega versus Pac versus Orange Cassidy in a triple threat match. In that match, I probably think that Omega will keep the title. I do eventually think that they will have Omega versus Orange Cassidy, and Orange Cassidy will win the title, but I don't know if they're going to have it done yet. Britt Baker will be facing Sheeta for the women's world title. I expect Britt Baker to finally win her first world title, as she's been very hot in terms of momentum, and you can kind of see it leading to this. So I expect her to get the championship for the first time. John Moxley, you guys know him as Dean Ambrose, so you're WWE fans. John Moxley and Eddie Kingston will be facing the Young Bucks. Young Bucks are considered one of the best tag teams in the world. They've had the titles for a few months, but this will be a good back and forth, and Moxley and Kingston have not lost a fight yet. And we'll see if that undefeated streak continues, or if the Young Bucks and their new attitude change will continue to be the champions. One thing that's going to be kind of surprising is Sting. Yes, Sting, face mask, bat in his hand, long trench coat from the rafters. Sting will wrestle. He is in a tag team match, and he will actually wrestle. This will not be a cinematic match. This is actually going to be a match. So just for the old school fans, and just to see Sting, you may think it's sad, you may think it's fun to see, but Sting will be in an actual wrestling match, and so that'll be something to watch and pay attention to. And obviously the big match of the night will be Jericho and his faction, the Inner Circle, versus MJF and his faction, the Pinnacle. If the Pinnacle wins, then Jericho's faction has to break up and never be put together again. Just because of that, I think Jericho and his team, the Inner Circle, will win. I've been a very big proponent of Sammy Guevara. I think he's going to be one of the future stars of wrestling. He's just very athletic. He has the charisma. He's starting to get better on the mic. He does have to get better there, but he has all the attributes to be a superstar in wrestling, and he's very young compared to a lot of wrestlers right now. If you look at the ages of a lot of wrestlers, they're in their mid-30s, late-30s, some even in their early 40s. You look at Sammy Guevara, and he's in his 20s, and that is the – I could see the future of wrestling being Adam Cole and Sammy Guevara, those two names being the future of the sport. So keep an eye on not only the Inner Circle, but especially Sammy Guevara. Justin, there was nothing really much to talk about on Raw and SmackDown. Roman's still the champ. He still has Jay and John Uso. He still has the Usos pretty much either fighting to be under him or fighting to get from under him. So we'll see what happens. They have a tag team match against the Street Profits. I'm sure it won't be a normal tag team match, because if it was, it would be a really great match. If it isn't, that match is tonight, by the way, and if it isn't going to be a normal match, which I don't expect it to be, it'll be just some BS to end it. I don't know how they'll find a way, or maybe one of the Usos will turn on the other or something like that, but nothing much about Raw and SmackDown to talk about. I think Roman will probably hold the title for about 3 years. I think WWE has waited for him to take his throne as a champion and not get hurt or not have to leave because of leukemia and cancer, not have to deal with the fans throwing stuff and getting mad at him. Well, they still could be mad at him, but now it's different because he's a heel and the fans want him as heel. And like I said, he's going to go on a long run before anybody beats him. NXT this past week, great match between Finn Balor and Karrion Kross. It was really about 20, 30 minutes of really, really good wrestling. He made Finn not tap out, but pretty much choked him out until he was unresponsive. But it was really, really good match between those two. You got to think of what they're going to do with Finn next. Is he going to go up to Raw and SmackDown? He talked about that on Ryan Statton's podcast. Is he going to go to UK and finally dethrone Walter? Walter's been champion for 2 years over there. Is he going to go and win that title from him? So they have a lot of different ways they could go with Finn Balor, but I think his time in NXT has come to an end. So we'll see what's next for him. In terms of Karrion Kross, I think he is NXT's version of Roman Reigns. He's never lost a fight. He had the title before, had to give it up the night after because of injury, and he's come back more powerful than ever, still hasn't lost a fight. And I think he's going to remain undefeated until he goes to either Raw or SmackDown. So you're going to see a lot of Roman Reigns and a lot of Karrion Kross as champion for a long time. And the only thing you can say about Raw is how many chances McIntyre going to get. Like, kind of tired of it. They seem to be trying to revive Kofi Mania again, which is pretty fun. I like that. But I just don't see what they're doing. I mean, Bobby Lashley is an okay champion, so I can see him being champ for a little bit, but it's definitely a title that's going to change hands pretty soon. And you just wonder what direction is Raw going to go with. Are they going to give it to McIntyre? Which, I mean, people are a little tired of seeing him now. It was great when he first came out last WrestleMania. He finally got his title after, I can't remember how many years, it was 10 years or whatever like that, 12 years. But he finally got a world title. He was a good champion. He finally lost. And then he just seems to be getting rematch after rematch after rematch, as Kofi Kingston brought out on his promo. So I'm a little, we'll see what happens if they give him more championship title runs, or if Bobby Lashley's going to keep it, if they go for Kofi Mania Part 2. But they definitely need something different on, as Raw. As Raw is the worst show of all the WWE NXT shows every week. So they got to figure something out to change something on Raw, because NXT is by far the best show. And SmackDown has the better wrestlers and is the better show, has the better characters. So Raw is just kind of there right now. They're just kind of repeating the same things every week. And something's going to have to happen soon, because fans are going to be back in July, and fans will let you know how they feel. So you're going to see a lot of fans booing a lot of the crap that they have on Raw if they don't change things up fast. So hopefully they'll get that changed around and put on some more entertaining stuff, because it's horrible right now on Raw. Switching to boxing, kind of connected with the wrestling, because SummerSlam, as most people know by now, is going to be in Vegas on August 21st weekend, which happens to be the same weekend as the recently announced fight of Manny Pacquiao and Errol Spence. So just a couple things on that. One, don't expect to get any cheap flights to Vegas on that weekend. Don't expect to get any cheap hotels to Vegas that weekend. If you haven't gotten your hotel and flight booked already, just be prepared to pay a lot, because wrestling fans are crazy. For all the boxing fans that don't know, wrestling fans are crazy. They will pay almost anything for a ticket, especially if it's one of their big four main events each year, which happen to be the Royal Rumble, Survivor Series, WrestleMania, and SummerSlam. And this is one of the big four. So it's going to be tough to get a normal ticket and a normal room in Vegas for that weekend of August 21st. So that's just a little heads up for the boxing fans. Now, I just want to talk about Terrence Crawford a little bit. Just, we had a little debate on Twitter about, we all know he's good. We know he's a great fighter. We know he's an all-time fighter. And a couple months ago, we had the debate of if he retired right now, is he Hall of Famer? Probably is, but I mean, obviously the Hall of Fame has a little bit to do with subjectivity, and it's just very subjective and whether you're liked and everything like that. So Hall of Fame may not be a good measure to really talk about how good a person is. Like I said, Crawford's a great fighter, but I just really want to see him fight against somebody that's even a top 25 pound for pound guy. And this was his chance. He had a chance to make this Pacquiao fight work. He could have been the guy fighting against Pacquiao, and money wise, it didn't work out. And it looks, and now it's going to be Pacquiao versus Spence. Now, Pacquiao is arguably the number three welterweight in the world, behind Crawford and behind Spence. Now, some people may even try to put him ahead of him. But the point is that those are the top three welterweights in the world. And with Spence now, if he beats Pacquiao and puts the number three welterweight on his resume, that trumps anything that Terrence Crawford has done in his career, or anything that he can do. Because the next best person he could fight is either Ugas, or he can fight against Porter. And either one of them, neither one matches up to a Manny Pacquiao. And even his own promoter, Bob Arum, is talking about how he doesn't really sell on pay-per-views. It's not really a great sell if you put Pacquiao against this guy. It's a bad situation for Crawford right now. And listen, I blame himself. I think he has to blame himself, because, one, he decides his career. He is the boss. If he wants a fight, that fight has to be done, or you change promoters. He decided to re-sign with Top Rank a couple years ago. He decided that this was his best way for his future, and I think he was wrong. I think that he's missed out on a lot of fights that he would have won that he hasn't gotten a chance to take because he re-signed with Top Rank. Whether it's a fight against Danny Garcia at 147 before Danny moved up to 154, as he's going to be fine at 154 now. Whether it's a fight against Ugas. Whether it's a fight against Crawford. Whether it's the fight that everybody wants to see against Errol Spence. All those fights are not happening because he decided to sign back with Top Rank and because he's not forcing the issue to get that fight done. And like I said, he has to blame himself for this. So I just want to see Crawford go. His best wins, Yurgis Gamboa, you got Postel, you got Amir Khan, you got Kell Brook. I mean, those guys are solid guys. They're even good for the division that they were in. But they're not guys that you're going to say they're top 20. They're not top 15 guys or top 20 guy pound for pound in the world. Those are just good, solid fighters. And Kell Brook arguably was done after he had his orbital bone broke twice. Amir Khan has one of the weakest chins in the sport. Gamboa, that was not his best weight as he had to fight at a heavier weight than he was used to. Postel, that was a really good win. Postel was probably the best in the division at that time at 140 when he beat him. So that was a good boxing win. But nobody really knows who Postel is outside of big boxing fans. So he has no names on his resume. While you look at the other side with Errol Spence, and he faces Porter, and people know who Porter is. He faced Danny Garcia. People know who Danny Garcia is. Now he's fighting Manny Pacquiao. Everybody knows who Manny Pacquiao is. And a lot of people are going to be seeing that fight. That pay-per-view could do close to a million buys. So everybody's going to see like this fight, and Terrence Crawford is going to be mentioned during that fight, obviously. And it's going to be another fight where he missed out on getting that big name on his resume. Sometimes you have to take a little less to think about the future and get more. I think taking less and beating Pacquiao would get Crawford more in the future than holding out for more money for that Pacquiao fight. So we'll see what happens as we move into August. We'll see what Crawford's going to do. But as I said, I don't think there's anything that he can do to trump what Spence is doing. He pretty much has to root hard for Pacquiao, and then he can try to make a Pacquiao fight again. Because if Spence wins, Spence has all the cards. Spence will be able to make pretty much a 65-35 percentage for the pay-per-view, if not 70-30. Because, like I said, I think that fight will do around $1 million. And even though it's mostly Pacquiao, Spence's name is on the list. And we know that Pacquiao has had some down numbers recently. So with his down numbers, if you see it spike back up to around $1 million, Spence is going to claim and say that's because he was fighting me, a top fighter. So I think Crawford has lost all leverage in the Spence versus Crawford debate or negotiations if Spence wins this fight. So we'll see what happens for that fight in August. Definitely we'll have another podcast regarding a few poor podcasts regarding it. Maybe I'll have a couple guests on to come on and talk about it. But just to talk about the other big boxing story, which broke about a week ago, Deontay Wilder. Deontay Wilder is back in the heavyweight situation. He will be actually fighting against Tyson Fury, and it looks like July 24th, and it completely kills the Tyson Fury versus Anthony Joshua mega UK fight that was planned to take place later on this year. Now, the fight can still take place. Fury can win against Wilder. We don't know how fast he wins or how fast he takes him out, and we could still have the fight between him and Joshua later. But the thing is, I just don't understand why that people just discounted that there was an arbitration case going on. And not only was there an arbitration case going on, Wilder was expected to win the case. I mean, he has it in the contract that he can get a rematch clause. Now, I don't know if Top Rank thought that COVID could slow this down and extend it so far that people forget about this, or people say, all right, then the time has run out. But it's in the contract. As long as it's in the contract, I don't want to hear all the UK fans bitching and complaining saying, oh, well, he's going to knock him out anyway, or why does he even want to fight, or he doesn't earn the fight. Like, that's stupid. He doesn't have to earn a fight. He signed a contract. If you know what a contract is binding. He has a contract that after that second fight, there was a two-fight contract, and he's going to get a rematch. And that's what's going to happen. So all the complaining about whether he deserves it or whether he'll get knocked out again or whether he was embarrassed so much, why should it even happen? It's going to happen because it was a contract made for it. And despite what you guys might want, this is what's going to happen. They're going to fight a third fight. He's already said he's not going to take step-aside money, even if it's $20 million. So they're going to fight. And after that fight, then we can move on to possibly Fury versus Joshua. And I say possibly because despite what a lot of people on boxing Twitter might think, Deontay Wilder's right hand did knock Fury down twice in the first fight. And in the second fight, it was just completely weird. And I said this on Twitter. I think Deontay Wilder has gotten too normal with his boxing. I mean, people used to make fun of him about it, but the big thing about him is that he was so unorthodox that he just threw the white right hand out of nowhere, and it was at a weird angle, and it'll just clip you, and if it clips you, you're going down. And I think now he's trying to be such a conventional boxer that now you can plan for it. You can see when the right hand's coming. So he has to find some way to kind of throw the right hand when you don't expect it instead of trying to hide it. I think those are the two ways to do it. You can try to fight somebody and hide when you're going to throw that big punch, or you can throw that big punch at a weird time, at a weird angle, and catch them by surprise. And I think Wilder's biggest thing was that the right hand could catch you out of nowhere. And now he's trying to hide it. And I don't think technically he's not a good enough boxer to hide the right hand. So he needs to go back to what he was doing before. Let it go. Go for that big punch. He can hold it for a little bit because that's what he did before. But just let it go at a weird angle, at a weird time. Catch him. And then all of a sudden, we got a new champion again. So I think this is the best chance for Wilder to fight Fury because The more active Fury is, the better he is. So if he gets a fight underneath his belt before a Wilder fight, I think that'll get him back into his boxing rhythm. There is a boxing rhythm. I don't care how much you spar. You got to be in a boxing rhythm. You got to have fights. You got to be active. And Fury hasn't fought. And at the time, it'll be 17 months since their last fight in February of 2020. So with them fighting, it's going to be an unbelievable sight to see Fury not fighting for 17 months. Wilder, if he lets the right hand go and just lets it fly, I think he has a legitimate chance to get more than a... Obviously, the saying is a puncher's chance. But I think because he's knocked him down twice before, I think he's a little bit more than a puncher's chance. I think he has a legitimate chance to knock him out. And obviously, the longer the fight goes, Fury may be able to figure him out. Maybe he gets back into rhythm and he finishes the match. But early in this fight, if Deontay Wilder in the first, I would say four to five rounds, if he lets his hands go and he just throws that right hand some little wildly, where you may see some memes about on Twitter, he can catch Tyson Fury and we can have a new champion. And then we could talk about the fight that I actually wanted to see, which I wanted to see Wilder versus Joshua. I'd rather see Wilder versus Joshua than Fury versus Joshua, because I know somebody's getting knocked out. If it's Fury, it could go to a decision. I think Fury's a better boxer. He can win. But in terms of having excitement and having America versus UK, having a knockout puncher versus a knockout puncher, I think that this, the best fight for us to see would be Deontay Wilder versus Anthony Joshua. But we'll see what happens with that fight. It's a long time away because we got to get through Fury versus Wilder first. Fury will obviously be the big favorite. He deserves to be. But me, for example, I'll be putting money down on a Wilder knockout because I think that's going to get a pretty good price. So that'll do it for this week and this episode of PAC Sports Zone. As I said, hopefully, there's been a lot of stuff going on, but hopefully you guys will start coming back with me, and we'll get on a normal schedule, and we'll start going every week. I think that as the season goes on in baseball, we're going to talk a lot more about that. NBA playoffs, NHL playoffs will be getting into their second and third rounds next week or in the next 2 weeks. We should be able to talk about some wrestling pay-per-views, and we get closer to SummerSlam in August. So lots of things for us to talk about as we get into the season. And it'll be just another month closer to football season and training camps. And as soon as we get close to August, we know preseason games are going to start again. 17-game regular season now in football, so get ready for that in fantasy leagues. I'll also have a lot of fantasy stuff coming on later on in the year as we get closer to the preseason. But with that, thanks for watching. Thanks for listening to Pac Sports Zone Podcast. I'm your host, the sports god, Peter Pacman Clarke, and I'll be with you back again next week. Peace out, guys.